ecosystems. Oftentimes we have sites that historically weren't fire maintained longleaf. They were cut over, they were abandoned, the mixed pine hardwood. And we reflexively, with many of our foresters, going to recommend very intensive site preparations that in the process eliminate a lot of that native ground cover. So we'll talk about some herbicides we may consider using at lower rates or not using, depending on what species we want to keep or get rid of. Restoration, we're going to talk about whether we use plants or seed, the various techniques involved. Availability, every species that we talk about today is commercially available from multiple sources. And we're going to have some additional reading and resources recommended throughout the presentation. One family that we've started paying a lot more attention to in recent years is Ericaceae, and it's often overlooked. I think a lot of the people who study the longleaf pine ecosystem recognize the value of the native herbaceous layer, but often they kind of forget about some of the shrubs, and that's where most of the plants in this family, the heath family, would be considered shrubs. You do have the tree sparkleberry, which makes a small tree. It's not unique to the southeast. It's a nationwide plant family. People from Alaska to Maine, on down here to lower Alabama and Florida, and the native range of longleaf pine, all are familiar with and go out and collect wild blueberries and huckleberries, two of the genuses, genera, that we're going to focus on today. There are several other genera in this plant family, but these are the ones we're going to be looking at this morning. Some of these plants have very low growth forms. Here's a photo. On the left, we have a small, what we call a low bush blueberry, a Vaccinium mercenitis, and on the right, with the larger berries, is a gay lusatia, probably Dimosa, two of the genuses we were talking about. And these are rhizomatous plants that you may have one large root system and multiple stems. This photo is taken on a stand that's burned every 2 years, and yet it produces a tremendous amount of fruit almost annually. So it takes a very short period of time for these species to recover and produce fruit, even following growing season fires. And because they're lower growing, they're accessible to some of our more important game species, such as the wild turkey and the bobwhite quail, but they're low enough ground that they're also accessible to non-game keystone species such as the gopher tortoise. And very widespread. If you go to any longleaf pine ecosystem in the southeast, whether it's from Virginia to Texas, that has never been through an intensive site preparation, you're going to have a good portion of that ground cover represented in the native Ericaceae, especially the vacciniums and the huckleberries. And we often see in our fire-maintained forest that up to half of the ground cover is the native Ericaceae. So very widespread species. These come on and start producing fruit as early as late May to June, and they're just finishing up now, the low bush blueberry, but the huckleberries are really starting to go here in July. If you exclude fire for a slightly longer period of time, the low bush blueberry reaches a maximum height generally about 2 to 3 feet, produces just a tremendous amount of fruit, BB-sized fruits that are really easily utilized by many species of birds. Very sweet, very good to eat. We collect and sell this at our local farmers market at a very high price per pound. We're going to be citing Miller and Miller a lot today because they have an excellent book that talks about the wildlife value of a lot of the shrubs we're discussing. And the native gay lusatias are huckleberries that you might find. Some of the more common species, gay lusatia dimosa, frondosa and mosuri, are utilized by the bobwhite, the wild turkey, and the ruffed grouse. Squirrels eat them, deer sprouts, leaves, and many species of songbirds are going to take advantage of these native huckleberries. One very important characteristic of the plant family Ericaceae is that it produces seed throughout most of the year. The Elliott's blueberry, Vaccinium Elliotti, may start blooming as early as February and producing fruit as early as April. Then we have the low bush that starts producing the Vaccinium mercenitis in the Darawai. Now the high bush blueberry are really producing at very high rates through June, through July, sometimes into early August. This is the Vaccinium corymbosum. This is the one that if you're going to go out and collect blueberries to eat, you can get a lot of volume in a short period of time. And this is the species that a lot of our cultivars that are available commercially, they come from this species, Vaccinium corymbosum. Another species that's producing this time of the year, that doesn't taste quite so good to us, but it's utilized by a lot of wildlife, is the Vaccinium staminium or deerberry. Kind of a sour off taste, at least to me. But it's a species that's very adapted to the longleaf pine ecosystem, so that if you burn frequently, it tends to be a very low growing shrub, maybe a maximum of 1 feet, and still producing a lot of fruits. If you burn less frequently, it can get up several feet tall, 5 to 6 feet tall, and produce hundreds of berries on a single bush, potentially thousands of berries on a single bush. And we're going to have several books that we recommend that you look up if you want to learn a lot more about the native longleaf pine ecosystem and the wildlife and the plants that they utilize. One in particular is Illumination in the Flatwoods. If you haven't found this book, it's an excellent read by Joe Hutto. What he did is he basically adopted two clutches of wild turkeys. He incubated them. When they hatched, they imprinted upon him, and then he spent a year out in the forest around the Apalachicola National Forest area of north central Florida, and watched these turkeys as they moved through the forest. What did they eat? How did they avoid predators? And one of the species that he mentions most frequently in his book that they really utilized through the summer was the deerberry, or the Vaccinium staminium, a very important food source. That one and rubus were probably two of the main plants that they consumed, according to his observations. Another species that produces a tremendous amount of seed is green right now. These fruit will not ripen until this fall. It is sparkleberry, or Vaccinium arboreum. And it's going to keep these seeds late into the winter months, so that you'll see the purple berries when they're ripe. Again, not one that we would find highly palatable, but the birds are just going to be really working on these late in the winter months, January and February, when there's very few other food sources available. So this one plant family, it starts producing seed as early as April, and they continue producing seed for our native game birds and songbirds well into February. There's very few plant families that produce that much seed over that long a period of time. This is a plant family that is not tolerant of the massapear, so if we do a very intensive site preparation, many foresters are going to fall back on a recommendation of Arsenal or Chopper, which again are massapear based. It's going to eliminate most of this plant family at the high end rate. So these plants are much more tolerant of hexazinone. It's another commonly used forestry site prep herbicide, so that if you do a site prep with a Velpar-L, a Velpar-DF, Velpar-ULW, Pronone, it's going to leave the sparkleberry in place. In fact, it's almost like you fertilized them. Sometimes we have a little too much sparkleberry, but we definitely don't want to eliminate the whole family, because then we'll have eliminated one of our primary wildlife food sources. In the process of getting the tree back, we can lose the ecosystem. Some other suggested reading by Miller and Miller, Forest Plants of the Southeastern or Wildlife Uses. Excuse me. And this is a great book for the layperson who doesn't have a lot of botanical training, because you don't have to work through a key. A lot of our keys how we work down to individual tree species, individual shrubs and herbaceous species, you have to have quite a knowledge of botanical terms. And you don't need that. You can flip through these excellent quality photographs. This is widely available. You'll find it on Amazon.com from the Southern Weed Science Society. On the left is a 1999. this is the 1999 edition, and then the revised edition came out in 2005. Native blueberries are utilized by black bears, a species we're hoping to get back across much of Alabama and much of the southeast. Rough grouse, wild turkey, quail, many songbirds, deer's browse, several of the species. Some species are very low preference, but especially here in the lower coastal plain, the deer really do seem to browse fairly heavily on the Vaccinium elliotti or the Elliott's blueberry. Where can we get the plants? These are going to be a little less available as a species than some of the other ingenious, than some of the other ones we'll discuss today. But Rancholot Orchidea in Milton, Florida has a very wide selection of native blueberries, including two species of low bush, the Vaccinium mercenides, Vaccinium darowii, the Elliott's blueberry, the high bush, the deerberry, and the sparkleberry. And they're available as what we call liner stocks. So if you're familiar with container grown longleaf and how we plant it, many of those longleaf, the vast majority are planted as container grown seedlings with what it's called a plug. It's about 6 cubic inches in volume, and that's how they produce these. And if you buy them in volume, these blueberries, you can get your cost down less than $1 per plant. And because the low bush blueberry is rhizomatous, we think that if we establish a few plants per acre in fire and time, we can potentially get back a good portion of that ground cover into the native vacciniums. Some other areas you can get the seedlings from: Superior Trees, the Florida Association of Native Plant Nurseries. It takes the information from dozens, perhaps hundreds of native nurseries and many, many hundreds of plant species. You can go to this website, type in the species you're looking for, and it'll tell you which nurseries provide the seedling. And they asked us to keep the audience engaged, to run a few short quiz questions as we're going through this presentation. Here's the first of three. Which of these blueberries keeps the fruit well into the winter months? Now I'll turn that over to Sarah.
All right, and I will take your responses till 3, 2, 1. Sparkleberry.
That's it, and it is sparkleberry. That is correct. Another species, unique to its genus, is beautyberry, and very common throughout the native range. This is a very attractive native shrub. The Latin on it is Calycarpa americana. Another common name is French mulberry. You find it all across the southeast in the native longleaf range. It's very fire adapted, a common occurring plant in the native longleaf pine ecosystem. Also, very tolerant of hexazonal. So this is another one of those genuses, and important plant foods that if you do a very intensive site preparation, an intensive mechanical, which digs up the root systems and eliminates it, or intensive chemical that is a massapyr based, again, both of those would get rid of most of your sparkleberry. But it is very tolerant of the hexazonone or Valpar products. And it's an important seed producer, especially for our native birds. It is browsed by deer, but the primary thing that's going to utilize this is many of our native bird, both game and non-game species, and they're going to utilize it very late in the year so that the seed will stay on, you know, dry well up through the first of the year, and then they're going to start really utilizing this, the birds are, in January and February. Some sources of beautyberry: Superior Trees in Florida. Again, check out FAN, the Florida Association of Native Plant Nurseries. Arborgen, which has nurseries across the southeast. There's a large one in Georgia, and the Southern Habitats actually sells the seed. The rest of these are going to be Arborgen, Florida Association of Native Plant Nurseries, and Superior Trees should have them available as bare root seedlings. Species that utilize beautyberry, more than 40 species of songbirds have been documented at eating the seeds. Deer do moderate browse. We really never see deer browse beautyberry here at the Solon Dixon Center in central lower Alabama, but as you go into western Alabama, you see that the plants are browsed very heavily, so it depends across the range. Some of our game species include bobwhite quail utilize it. Herbert Stoddard documented this in a good portion of the crops that they examined. Raccoons, opossums, and armadillos also utilize the beautyberry. A genus that many more people are going to be familiar with is the prunus, the native wild plums, a very diverse genus across the longleaf pine ecosystem. One of the ones that people are more commonly familiar with is the Chickasaw palm, or Prunus angustifolia, and there's going to be a lot of variation, not just between species, but also within species, so that some of your Chickasaw palms, when the fruit is ripe, will be as pictured, kind of a pinkish red color. Some are going to be a very dark purple. Some are going to be yellow. And the taste, apparently, is all pretty good for wildlife. To us humans, some of them are going to be very tart, while others are going to be quite sweet, and that's going to vary from tree to tree. Some of the more common species we'll come across, again, Chickasaw palm is Prunus angustifolia. American plum produces the largest and sweetest of the fruits for human consumption, so that's a great one to consider if you want to. You're one of those foragers like me that likes to have something around to eat in the summertime. The slow hog or flatwoods plum are all common names for Prunus umbellata, which is one of the smaller of the plum species. It's going to be a little easier for some of the species like wild turkey to eat this as a whole fruit. And it's also extremely tart. Makes a good jelly. Laurel cherry is one that we would caution probably against planting for a lot of people. It is the only one that is an evergreen Prunus species. And it has proven to be somewhat invasive, and in some areas very invasive tree species. If you get down around Pensacola, Florida, you'll see large acreages covered up with laurel cherry. It's spreading just like, unfortunately, like our privet. And so we'd be somewhat cautious of recommending the laurel cherry or Prunus caroliniana. Where can we, what are the species that utilize the Prunus? Quail, especially. Utilize it for escape cover, nesting cover. Many species of songbirds have been shown to utilize this. Deer, blackberry, gray fox, raccoon, and opossum. The escape cover, nesting cover that we mentioned, we know, for instance, we know a biologist and land manager in central Alabama who's planted quite a few acres of wild plums. And then every fall and winter, we have a migration of hawks that come through. That's when we're going to lose a lot of our quail to predation. And Ted says that it's quite common for him to find coopers, for instance, and sharps and hawks with broken wings in this cover, because this is where the quail escape these during that hawk migration. Some sources very widely available. For instance, North Carolina, South Carolina, Georgia forestry commissions all sell various species of Prunus. Superior Trees in Florida has three different species available. ArborGen, and then you can get just a whole array of this species if you search on FAN, the Florida Association of Native Plant Nurseries. Most of these, again, are available as bare root species. Oftentimes, you can get your cost down into the 10 to 30 cent range if you buy in volume. Another question from our list. Of the species that we just talked about, which one can become invasive so that we would caution probably against planting for most people? Would it be A, Chickasaw plum, B, American plum, C, slow hog or flatwoods plum, or D, laurel cherry? And Sarah?
Okay, I'm going to publish the results in 3, 2, 1.
Excellent. That is correct. Prunus caroliniana. Okay, Truth in Advertising. The photo is actually of a cultivar. This may not be, or probably is not, Malus angustifolia, which is the species that is native to the southeast and most of the native range of the longleaf pine. It is one that a lot of deer hunters are going to be familiar with, because it makes a fruit that ripens later in the fall, may keep the fruit well into the winter months, and that's when the deer in particular are going to utilize it, but other game species such as the turkey take advantage of it. It is native, and it is, you will find it out there in the farm-maintained longleaf pine ecosystem. If you're burning regularly, it's going to keep it fairly low to the ground and probably not going to produce a lot of fruit, but if you give it 3-4 years, oftentimes it'll get large enough to produce a significant amount of fruit. Another book we highly recommend Deer and Turkey Management Beyond Food Plots. This is by Kent Kammermeyer and Reggie Thaxton. It was published in 2010. And they have a whole chapter on planting the native crab apples, the Malus species, including Malus angustifolia, the native southern crab apple. They talk about where you can get them, what species you can utilize, and which cultivars are suitable for which selection. Some sources of the native crab apples and some of the cultivars that may be not be native, but we haven't seen to be invasive so far. The North Carolina Forest Service lists Malus species, so I'm not exactly sure which one they have. Arborgen has the southern crab apple, which is the Malus angustifolia. And South Carolina, Georgia Forest Commission, Superior Trees, and again the Florida Association of Native Plant Nurseries. Now, moving down into a little bit wetter sites, and this might not be something that people would think to be a native species in the longleaf pine ecosystem, but it certainly is. What you have across much of the South is you have farm-maintained uplands that support the longleaf and incredible diversity in the herbaceous layer. And then if you get into the karst topography, like such as we have here in South Alabama, what happens is water runs beneath the ground through the limestone, it eats it out, it collapses into these sinkholes, and that's where we'll have water standing for long periods of time, and you'll find buttonbush in these sinkholes. So if you're like me, I do quite a bit of duck hunting, and because these sinkholes are surrounded by the longleaf pine ecosystem, there may not be a lot of acorn production right around the sinkholes, but right down in the sinkhole we have a lot of the buttonbush. And of course all of our where we have beaver ponds and our drainages through here, anywhere that you keep water for a long period of time, you might find this Cephalanthus occidentalis of the buttonbush, and it's just a very, very highly preferred food source for the ducks in the winter months of the South. Wildlife utilization, Miller and Miller talk about the waterfowl again. Wood ducks and mallards are going to eat the seeds, but really any duck that is going to be migrating through the area is going to take advantage of the buttonbush. Songbirds, many species eat the seeds. It's a very attractive small white pom-pom type flower in the spring that just gets covered up with native butterflies and pollinators. These species are very easy to plant. The buttonbush from a bare root stock is one that you should consider if you're going to be planting wetter areas to create food for waterfowl, but also stream bank stabilization. This is a great alternative. It can tolerate being underwater and inundated for months at a time. Very easy to plant, so one to certainly consider. Where can we get buttonbush? The Virginia Division of Forestry, Superior Trees, Louisiana Department of Agriculture, Arborgen, and the Florida Association of Native Plant Nurseries. One question may come up is, well, how did we select the nurseries that we included? Because there's many, many fold more nurseries that grow these plants. We just took nurseries, by and large, that also grow longleaf pine seedlings, and all of their contact information for virtually every one of these nurseries is also on the longleaf nursery list. This information is provided free of charge through our website, or you can contact the Longleaf Alliance and we'll send you the longleaf nursery list. And again, most all of these nurseries also produce longleaf pine seedlings. Another species that may be a little less widely recognized, certainly less widely recognized by many people who work out in the longleaf pine forest, is a false indigo, Amorpha fruticosa. It's a very widespread species, not just to the longleaf pine ecosystem. It goes all the way up to Canada and all the way down to Mexico. But it is fairly common in the longleaf pine ecosystem. So when I was doing my master's research at Itchway Plantation in South Georgia, this was growing all over the banks of the Itchway-Nachway Creek. It was growing on the banks of the Flint River up into the longleaf pine stands. Here at the Solon Dixon Center in Lower Alabama, we find it from the edge of the Conecuh River up into the lower portions of kind of flatwood stands of our longleaf pine ecosystem. It is very, very easy to plant. as a bayreuth seedling. This previous photo are, it's about 4 years post-planting along a stream on our farm. And 4 or 5 years post-planting, they are producing tremendous amounts of seed. In fact, you can collect in some kinds up to 1/2 pound, maybe even 1 pound of seed per plant just a few years post-planting. Very easy to plant, very prolific as a bayreuth seedling. Another one that can tolerate very wet sites. It can tolerate heavy soils or sandy loams, so a very wide array of soil conditions. Can be inundated for weeks or months at a time and is still going to survive and grow. It does, we think, have a fair bit of ornamental potential because it's got kind of a tropical type appearance to the foliage. Gorgeous deep blue to purple flowers, often with orangish yellow anthers, and it's just covered up with native pollinators in spring. This is the only shrub that we have planted in our yard at our new home site. Not as many sources for native false indigo, Amorpha fruticosa. You will want to check with the Florida Association of Native Plant Nurseries. We are collecting seed and providing it to some of the seed companies, and I think there's going to be a lot more commercial production in the near future. Missouri Department of Conservation has been selling bayreuth seedlings for some time. Some more suggested reading. Two excellent guides, again, ones that you don't have to have a lot of botanical knowledge to utilize. You can flip through and look at the photos, and they're just very, very high quality images. On the left is Field Guide to Common Legumes of the Longleaf Pine Ecosystem. This is produced by the Joseph W. Jones Ecological Research Center in association with the Georgia Native Plant Society. This is one for the native legumes, and then over here is a field and restoration guide to common native warm season grasses of the longleaf pine ecosystem, again in cooperation with the Georgia Native Plant Society, funding from National Fish and Wildlife Foundation, and Roundstone Seed Company, who does a lot of work with Ishiwe on producing native seeds for restoration purposes. A third one that you might want to consider if you're in wet sites and you're looking to produce seed during the summer months, which is often a limited food time for some of our native songbirds, is the elderberry or Sambucus canadensis, another species that can tolerate very, very wet sites and periodic inundation. Often it's available, generally is available as a bayreuth species. A lot of the native plant nurseries sell them as large potted plants. Something to keep in mind, virtually the entire plant is poisonous to humans. That would include the foliage, the stems, and the roots. Even the fruit, when it's green, is toxic, but once it turns purple, then it becomes edible. It is widely utilized. You'll find it in native health food stores. Because it's tested out in NIH studies to alleviate symptoms of the flu and other maladies, so you'll find elderberry extract available at a very high cost per fluid ounce. We sell it down at our local native plant at our native farmers market in Palafox, Pensacola, and it makes just one of the prettiest jellies you've ever seen. Wildlife utilization, boy, it's utilized by a lot of animals and plants. You can find it utilized by bobwhite quail, turkey, ruff, grouse, and mourning dove. Those are our game birds. More than 50 species of native songbirds have been documented eating the berries of the wild elderberry. And although the foliage is toxic, if we were to eat it, deer do occasionally browse it. A few sources for elderberry plants include Superior Trees of Florida, Arborgen across the Southeast, and the Florida Association of Native Plant Nurseries. Our third quiz question, and I think this is the final one for the presentation. One plant group is adapted to drier upland sites, and this other plant group is suited to wet soils and periodic extended inundation. Which of these two groups grows the best on the dry sites? Sarah?
All right, I will publish the results in 3, 2, 1.
100%. Excellent. That is correct. It is the beautyberry, the wild plums, the chinquapin we're going to be talking about very soon, and the native Lespedeses are all more of upland sites. Species we do not want to plant. This is what we put this webinar together for, is to promote native species and to get away from some of these terribly invasive Asian Lespedeses. These would include Lespedes bicolor, Lespedes plumbergi. Some of these go by the names Amquail Lespedesa or Attaway Lespedesa. All of them are highly invasive. Less invasive on our sandier soils, but they do move. This is down on the soil in Dixon Center again. Primarily we have sands, loamy sands, sandy loams, but it is starting to move along the roads. It'll move along fire lines. As you get into the heavier soils of North Alabama, you'll find it just taking over whole mountainsides, becoming forest of Lespedesa bicolor. What we tell our members is that if you budget $1 to plant it, budget $10 to control it down the road. And some people say, well, it's not spreading on my site, but unless they're putting diapers on the songbirds, that seed is going to pass through the digestive tract, the very hard seeds on a fair number of these species, and it's going to be pooped out somewhere. And we do find it growing in places you would not expect, where the landowner says, well, I don't have it spreading, but it is spreading out there. They're just not immediately evident. A great publication that recommends control and identification of the Asian species is the USDA Forest Service Technical Report, SRS 62. I'll show you this in the following slide. But it recommends to control Asian Lespedesas, we use Garland 4 as a 2% solution. Glyphosate, you're going to be familiar with Roundup or Cord, is a 2% solution. Transline is a fairly legume-specific herbicide, only a 0.2% solution. And then here at Escort, a Metsulfuron, they're going to recommend a per acre rate of 3/4 ounces per acre. This is, again, the image is called Non-Native Invasive Plants of the Southern Forest, a Field Guide for Identification and Control by Jim Miller, one of the world's leading experts, certainly here in the Southeast, on invasive plant species and their control measures. And this is available, I believe, free of charge if you contact the Forest Service through the Southern Research Station and request SRS-62. What are some good native alternatives? Well, one of my favorites, and one we think that has a lot of commercial potential, is hairy Lespedesa or Lespedesa hirta. This is, we put up the Longleaf Alliance office in 2001, and here's a little native plant garden out in front of our office. And I planted this bare root Lespedesa hirta right here about 2001 to 2002. And believe it or not, we burn off this little patch every other year, and most of the rest of these plants that are coming up have come up from seed. We find Lespedesa hirta maintaining itself in some of the intensively raked pine straw stands where they've eliminated virtually all the other native ground cover. It is persisting and even spreading in some of these intensively disturbed pine straw stands. It is one of the species we find coming back within a few years on some of the CRP plantings, one of the very few native Lespedesas that we see coming back on its own. So we know that we can plant it, and it'll survive for many, many decades from a bare root seedling, but it also appears to be fairly well suited for restoration using seed. Another one that's fairly common across the native range tends to be on a little bit more mesic sites. That's a little bit more moisture. That's your roundhead Lespedesa or Lespedesa capitata. Whereas the Lespedesa hirta, the previous slide, you're going to find it more on your sand hill site. Recommend strongly if you can acquire it. Unfortunately, it might cost you $200-$300 for a copy of it. Is the bobwhite quail, its habits, preservation and increase by Herbert Stoddard. It's considered the Bible of quail management, and it was originally published in 1932, republished in 1992. But it's a little. This one's a little more difficult to get a hold of. But it included within this. They have a table where they examined the stomachs of 1,659 bobwhite quail, and it talks about all the incredible diversity of plants and native herbaceous and shrubby species and woody species that they found in the stomachs of these bobwhite quail. One of the more common things they found were the native Lespedeses. This is one that really drove longleaf quail populations in the southeast. Some of the more common species that we're going to find, again, the hairy Lespedesa, Lespedesa hirta, brown hib is Capitata, slender is Virginica, and then the trailing and creeping that run along the ground are the Lespedesa procumbens and repens. And there's many other species, but these are the ones that you're most likely to find commercially. Wildlife utilization, Mill and Miller say that this is likely the most important northern bobwhite seed producer in the southeast, or in plural because it's multiple species. Deer, some species are preferred, others less so, but it's really the game birds that are going to utilize the seed of the native Lespedesas. Where can we get them? Very happy to see the North Carolina and Georgia Forestry Commission producing native bare root Lespedesas, no longer supplying the invasive Asian species. You can find several species through FAN. Roundstone Seed Company is one of the few seed companies producing the seed directly for sale to the public. And it's a very expensive seed per pound, but we think it might only take an ounce or a few ounces per acre to get a good representation back of some of these native Lespedesa species. Invasive, Eleagnosus, ones to stay away from, again, terribly invasive species from Asia, Eleagnus umbellata, Russian olive, and silverthorn. These are ones we want to replace with natives. They are becoming very invasive, even on some of our sandier sites here at the Dixon Center. These have moved away from a food plot, now spreading to the forest. In another great publication that talks about the control, not necessarily control, but the identification of the native plant, invasive plants of the southeast, is Forest Service General Technical Report SRS-119. This one does not have the recommendations for control like the previous one does, but it does help you to identify them. Again, this one should be available free of charge from the USDA Forest Service. What is a good alternative to these invasive Eleagnuses? Chinkapin would be right at the top of my list, one of the great nut-producing native species, one of the very few that produces a nut that you can eat right off the plant. Very sweet, very delectable even to us humans. Unfortunately, being closely related to the American chestnut, it does get chestnut blight. So if you can see here on the left, this is a portion of the tree that died this year. And eventually the entire tree will die back to the root system, but it'll come back. And it's been through this cycle many times over the years. So if you allow it a few years to recover after it has been top killed by the chestnut blight, it's going to be producing seed again. Consumed by squirrels, chipmunks, opossums, deer, quail, grouse, wild turkey, and many other game species. This is citing Kim Lamar and Thaxton's book. Some sources, Virginia, Department of Forestry, Arborgen, FAN, and Superior Trees. A herbaceous species, or genus, we should say, that's widely recognized as an important plant food is the rubus. These can be very problematic for people who are seeking to restore longleaf because they can be extreme competitors until you get your longleaf out of the grass stage. This is generally not something we have to actively restore. It will come back. They're ruderal. In other words, when you disturb a site, an ultimate disturbance is a clear cut, you're going to get the blackberries back. Oftentimes we want to control it until we get our trees established, so metsulfuron escort is the preferred herbicide for controlling blackberries, at least until you get your trees established. The ones we call blackberries are erect. The dewberries are the ones that run along the ground, Rubus trivialis and flagellus. There's just a many, many species in this genus. They come on about a month ahead of time on flowering and fruiting compared to the native blackberries, which have the erect growth form. But they can produce fruit over about a two-month period between the dewberries and the blackberries. Very important plant families. When we were out collecting fruits for our native farmers market, we found twice we kicked turkeys up from nests that were directly underneath blackberry thickets. Kim Lamar and Thaxton say collectively rubus, the blackberries, arguably the most important group of plants for wildlife in the southeast. Kim Lamar and Thaxton users include more than 100 species of songbirds, game birds, game mammals. The leaves are a very most important source of browse for deer and rabbits. And we're getting near the end of our list of species. This is just an example of a native that's often overlooked. It's wax myrtle. It is. It can be an attractive shrub in a yard if you leave it unburned. It can get fairly large in size. If you take fire out of the forest for a long period of time, you have solid walls of wax myrtle in many of the lower coastal plain forests. But if you burn on a regular basis, for instance, this is burned every 2 years, wax myrtle, again, is a very important native component of this forest, and you can keep it down about 1 to 2 feet in height. And even at this low height, it can produce a tremendous amount of seed because it's adapted to frequent fire. The problem with wax myrtle is when you take fire out of the forest, then it becomes an impenetrable wall. Utilized very widely by quail, turkey, and waterfowl, many species of songbirds, deer browse sparingly. Native sources, Arborgen, Superior Trees in Florida, the Georgia Forestry Commission, and the Florida Association of Native Plant Nurseries. Vitis, another genus, very diverse. There's quite a few species that you'll find out in a native longleaf pine ecosystem. One of the most commonly recognized ones is and found is Vitis rotundifolia or wild muscadine. This is the one that's great to eat directly off the vine. It's also utilized by a lot of wildlife. There are two species that have very small fruits that are widely utilized by wildlife, and they go by common names such as coon, summer, or winter grapes. They are very tart, not that great for human consumption, but they make fantastic jellies or wines. Two examples are Vitis estivalis and Vitis cinerea. Widely utilized by a lot of wildlife, including black deer, turkey, ruffed grouse, raccoon, opossum, gray squirrel, and striped skunk. Many species of songbirds, and it's listed as preferred forage for deer. We didn't, again, spend very much time on native herbaceous plants. That's not because they're important. It's because Carol is going to give an excellent presentation, a webinar on this in just a couple weeks, and we had a limited amount of time, so we're going to leave it up to Carol. But for additional information on where to get native seeds, check out this website. It's called the SNPRSIP, the Southern Native Plant Restoration and Seed Increase Project. They are working together with collaborators from across the Southeast who are looking to increase native seed production. We have hired Carol Denhoff, who is an understory coordinator with Longleaf Alliance, been with us for a couple of years now, and she is our main person to contact for information on native plants and seeds and plant availability. We're holding two understory academies. One September 18th through 20th in Tifton, Georgia, focused on native understory restoration and management. Another one October 2nd through 4th at the Solon Dixon Center in Andalusia, Alabama. I believe the September one is already fully booked, but we might still have a few slots here at the Solon Dixon Center for October 2nd through 4th. To register, contact JJ at longleafalliance.org. Upcoming webinars. The Basics of Understory Establishment Enhancement. Carol will be delivering that one on July 27th, and I will be following up with Native Plant Utilization Part 2 on August 17th, 2012. That's available also through Southern Regional Extension Forestry through this webinar portal. Just a quick little note. We will be focused more, we'll have a little bit more information on the August 17th presentation on herbaceous plants, but mainly on hardwoods. One of my favorite herbaceous species over here is Centrosema virginianum, a spurred butterfly pea. I think it has a tremendous potential for native understory restoration. It's an important and well-documented quail food if you read Stoddard's book on quail. Roundstone is growing and producing Centrosema virginianum. I'm not familiar with any other companies at this time, but hopefully we get more of them producing it. We've done a little direct seeding trials here at the Dixon Center and have found that with 1 pound per acre, we got many thousands of plants, and many of them were up and producing seed the very first year. So it has a lot of potential. Nitrogen fixing, native legume, very attractive, so it'll add aesthetic value to the forest and a lot of seed for quail and turkey. We're going to be holding our regional conference October 23 through 25, 2012 in Nacogdoches, Texas. This will be a great opportunity to see the Angelina National Forest, some longleaf restoration on an Alexander WMA in Texas, and a lot of presentations on wildlife and native understory restoration. Final slide. For more information, contact Carol. Again, our understory coordinator for longleaf alliance, or visit our website, www.longleafalliance.org. And that wraps it up. So, Sarah, what do we need to do next?
Well, we still have a few minutes, so I would just like to throw out to anybody that's on the webinar, if you'd like to ask a question, go ahead and type it in the chat box in your participant panel. And if there are no questions, I will go ahead and send out the URL for you guys to take the post-webinar survey and get your CFEs. And also, I would just quickly like to thank the J.R. Dobbs Foundation for financially supporting the Longleaf Summer Webinar Series. And like Mark said, there will be Longleaf webinars over the next 5 weeks, every Friday at noon Eastern time. So thank you very much for participating. Oh, it looks like we have a question.
Okay, we got a question. I mentioned, let me see, let's go back up here. Varying tolerance to herbicides such as Masperia, hexazonal for some plants. Do you have a list of natives and their tolerance? And the answer is no. I wish we did. I think this is one of the great holes in forestry research. Everything that has been conducted with herbicides has been directed at tree tolerance and the goal of killing everything else that was green. So that often you go out on these tours with the herbicide companies and the best sites, and that's in quotation marks, were the sites where they killed everything that wasn't a tree with the goal of maximizing survival and growth. But now we need to be paying attention not just to what the herbicides kill, but to which ones they leave behind. This would be just a fantastic area of study for Masters of Science and PhD students. I'd like to see many more universities across the South focused on restoration of longleaf pine ecosystem. And it's just a tremendous hole in our research. So we got to go with anecdotal information, what we can tell you, what we've seen. I'm sorry about that. A previous question from James T. above.
Yes, that's correct, and I can tell you he asked if some of these plants were shade tolerant.
Oh, yes, that's correct. Shade tolerant, the vacciniums, the gay lusaceas, that's the blueberries and huckleberries, are, you'll find good representation of these species beneath partial canopies. That's those are very good examples. The American beautyberry, you're going to find it right out there in a fairly dense canopy forest. So those are some. The native legumes are all tolerant of some shade to a certain degree. And when I did my master's research looking at the native legumes of the longleaf pine ecosystem, the diversity and the abundance went down with increasing basal area. So the more trees you had, the less herbaceous layer diversity you had. But they're all tolerant to some degree. The native legumes might be good examples.
All right, any other questions? If not, I will go ahead and push this URL out to you. I'm also going to copy and paste it into the chat box.
Question, can a butterfly pea grow in Texas? I'm 95% sure it's going to be native to Texas. The place to check USDA has a plant site that shows the native ranges of all of these species. You can find that fairly quickly. If you search on a Latin name, generally one of the first hits that come up is the USDA plant database. But I'm almost certain butterfly pea grows across the entire range of longleaf pine. Quercus pumila, the running oaks are a great one. We just had a limited amount of time, and I had to hit some of my favorites. Donald Lee Francis mentions Quercus pumila. Yeah, those are great ones, especially for turkey and deer. Just a limited amount of time, and we had to pick some of the highlights. Sorry about that.
Okay, last call on questions. All right, thank you very much, Mark. And like I said, I will push this URL out to you, and you need to go to it to collect your CFEs, and I will also copy and paste it into the chat box. So thank you very much for participating today. And hopefully we'll see you next week and the next 4 weeks after that.
Thanks a lot, Sarah.